Let's see if we can just cover everything, as we always seem to do. QE2 just zoomed by. QE2, pretty interesting name, right? Wonder what QE3 is going to do. Quantitative easing 1, quantitative easing 2, quantitative easing 3. What's quantitative easing 3 going to be? Collapse? Collapse is coming, there's no question. I was shown there was 2 minor adjustments, kind of thing. Now, it could have been quantitative easing 1, 2. That is possible. There's definitely 2 steps, small steps, before the whole thing comes down. We'll call that QE3. So the asteroid QE2 goes whizzing by a mile in diameter, as compared to the 10-mile diameter asteroid that came to Earth, visited Earth in the Age of the Dinosaurs, which brought a near extinction level event, ELE event, to this planet 66 million years ago. 66, interesting number. So we have that taking place. Now, Jesus said that, in A Course in Miracles, said that the real problem is we had this completely whimsical, eccentric idea, and we forgot to laugh at it. And he said, that's the whole thing. We forgot to laugh. We should have just laughed at it as completely silly. But we didn't laugh at it. And he also says that once we laugh at it, we'll be free of it. So you might say, to sum it up, the whole problem is we take this whole thing too seriously. In fact, taking it seriously at all is the problem. What are we taking seriously? Spirit's attempt to become prime creator. And more to the point, spirit's attempt to die. We should laugh at that. And we don't. All of this is ridiculous. And we think that we need answers. How can we find an answer to the attempt to accomplish the impossible? What kind of answer is there except to say it's not possible? But we say, oh, but the body needs answers. I need to give answers to the body because the body's been dying. I need to give answers to the personality. I need to find answers. Spirit will say, I don't need answers, but the personality needs answers. The personality and the body is not life. It's not alive. It's completely, they don't need any answers. What answers does the body need? What answers does the personality need? Spirit thinks that it's getting answers for the personality. The personality is nothing. Body is nothing. What's going on there? Birds are moving around here. Personality, the body, what answers do they need? We take it seriously, like we're trying to find answers for the body. Spirit will say, oh yeah, I don't need any answers, but the body. The body's the one that's been dying, so it needs answers for that. It's absurd. It's absurd. In this world, the problem is that we all take this whole thing seriously. Whereas actually, it is just a completely ridiculous farce. Something you should just laugh away, and that's it. But anyone who doesn't take us seriously is deemed to be insane here. But really, there is no seriousness to anything that's happening here whatsoever. The body is entirely neutral. It's like it's just as neutral as a sock puppet. So is the personality, actually. There's no identity there at all. There's nothing there that could possibly require any answers whatsoever. And since spirit can't die, it doesn't need any answers either. So what do we need answers for? So obviously when we're laughing, we're not focusing on getting answers. When we say serious, it means we're trying to find answers. Trying to find answers. And we don't need answers. So our correct condition is bliss and laughter. But it's not allowed here. It's not allowed, which is why I say distancing from this place is the remedy. At least it's a partial remedy. We have to pretend like we're in high-speed pursuit of answers. We don't need any answers. Who needs answers? What is the question? How to die? How cannot die. And the spirit says, oh no, the body's been dying. I need to teach the body how not to die. No, it's spirit that cannot die. All this form, everything was never alive in the first place. So what is never alive can hardly be said to die. It's a meaningless statement. Personalities, bodies, all this stuff was never alive in the first place. What dies was, it was never life, never part of life. So the concern about curing dying is ridiculous. Nothing real has ever died, so what is it, what do we apply the cure to? What was never alive in the first place? Which is what, just a hypothetical? A hypothetical? Why do we need to give a hypothetical cure to a hypothetical? Other than just to deal with a continuity issue. That could be the only reason. And a continuity issue would not be struggling in that way. The resolution would not be struggling that way. So this world is not serious. Really, all we should do is laugh about it. It's totally laughable. Totally laughable what's taking place here. The thing is, if we start laughing, we're afraid we'll never stop. So we have this laughter within us, we have this bliss within us, but we were afraid, like, oh my gosh, I'll never be able to stop it. I'll never be able to get serious again. That is true. Once we see through this charade, this farce, we can never take it seriously again. Never. And then we feel we'll no longer be part of humanity or something. What is humanity? Humanity just means spirit taking this seriously. That's what really humanity is. There is no such thing as humanity, actually. Humans, personalities, they're nothing. Nothing at all. They're just temporary hypotheticals, simulation symbols. No life there at all. Never was. But it's spirit that's when spirit takes this quest seriously of how to die, then it imagines itself to be that there's a humanity. And it needs to be taken seriously. There is no such thing. There's no such thing as humanity, actually. No such thing as nature, either. It's not there. It's not there at all. It's only us projecting our seriousness that we're experiencing. We're simply experiencing the projection of our own seriousness. That's it. We can also project our own laughter and experience that too. Project our own carefreeness, which is bliss. Project our own freedom from care, true freedom from any concern, which is bliss. We could also experience that. And we say, well, we're not part of humanity. There is no humanity to be part of. It's more accurate to say we wouldn't be part of this serious quest. The seriousness is the only part of the quest there is. Without the seriousness, there is no quest. In other words, that only seems to be a quest because we're taking it seriously. If we didn't take it seriously, there wouldn't be any quest. We just realize, this is a complete absurdity. This idea of spirit dying is a complete absurdity. So, how could there be a quest, a meaningful quest for what's impossible? There cannot be. So we're really experiencing our own projections. Spirit is only experiencing its own projections. It's experiencing its seriousness, its intent. And it puts symbols out there to reflect this projection back so it doesn't think it's projecting. So it the seriousness then takes the form of humanity. and the world and existence, it seems full of purpose and intent, and spirit doesn't realize it's its own seriousness that is being reflected back to it. It's like a mirror. It's like thinking that what you see in the mirror is coming from the mirror. It's not. It's a mirror, just reflection. So all these humanity, all this stuff, bodies, seem to have seriousness, serious intent in themselves. They don't. They have no serious intent. The body, the personality, all this actually is devoid of any intent whatsoever. Just like a mirror is devoid of intent. The mirror is not intending to reflect the what's in the mirror. It's not saying, I want to reflect this body or this person or whatever. No, the mirror is just neutral reflection. Neutral reflection. So the body in nature in all form is neutral reflection. It has no intent of its own to, no agenda to reflect this or that or whatever. Neutral. All symbols are really just neutral. Okay, so, but spirit can trick itself thinking, oh no, it's humanity is in this quest. Humanity has a serious quest. It has no quest whatsoever. Our nature has this serious purpose. Nature has no purpose. None. So asking the questions like, what's the purpose of humanity? What's the purpose of nature? Is itself a delusional statement that has no purpose. It's simply a tool, a simulation tool, a training tool that spirit's using so that spirit doesn't recognize its own absurdity. Okay? It's a way for spirit to maintain its serious intent, thinking it's coming from somewhere else. If it realizes it's only coming from spirit, then it'll easily, you know, easily can drop it. See? It doesn't guarantee it will drop it, but it virtually does, but not absolute guarantee. I mean, spirit could see that it's only all coming from spirit, and then decide to project it again. It's free to do that. But virtually, when spirit says it realizes that this joke is playing on itself, then it will start laughing. It will start laughing at that, and then the whole serious thing it's not serious anymore. So the way that spirit prevents this is to think it's coming from the mirror, but it's projecting it onto. It believes the serious intent is coming from nature. It's coming from humanity. And so then spirit is saying, oh, I need to help. I need to help. I'm in a supportive role here. Humanity has this serious quest, and I'm just here to help them realize their quest. Humanity wants to be enlightened. I'm just here to help that enlightenment. I'm just here to help. I'm here to inspire. I'm in a supportive role. I'm trying to inspire nature. I'm trying to inspire humanity. They have this amazing purpose and quest they're on, and I'm trying to help them realize this, realize their potential and all this stuff. All of that is the total delusion. That's how spirit maintains its own quest. By thinking its quest, it's someone else's quest. All these little birds are making their way through the yard, hopping all over the place here. They're on a quest. So, again, when spirit can see that all of this is its quest to die, and the body and personality, nature have no quest of all of their own. Spirit has imagined all this to hide its own folly from itself. And thinking, oh, look at nature. Everything's impermanent. Everything's dying. Nature's on this death quest. Or bodies are on this death quest. I wonder how it's going to turn out, etc. Yeah. It just continues on and on and on until it's realized that it's a projection from spirit. And then spirit laughs. It continues until spirit remembers to laugh at itself, at its silly quest. It all continues until spirit no longer takes itself serious, its quests to die seriously. And once that happens, then bodies, forms, personalities, nature, all that then just merely reflects laughter and carefreeness and bliss. And then once that laughter and bliss becomes totally familiar to spirit, then spirit drops all hypotheticals, what ifs, all training altogether. Spirit doesn't need any training to be what it is. It's created, its functionality was created perfectly. It doesn't need to a manual on how to function. It doesn't need to learn how to function, etc., etc. So we have forgotten. Spirit again is taking itself seriously and projecting this seriousness onto nature and bodies, etc. It made nature and bodies in order to project this crazy quest onto. That's why. And then Spirit claims that, oh, God created all this. This is all God's creation. Really? God created all this impermanence? No, it did not. This is so. It's not as difficult as we assume, yet in a world where everyone is, the Spirit is taking it so seriously and the projections are so extreme, it's very difficult to just sit back and laugh. One of the reasons that people use drugs, for instance, like marijuana is becoming, you know, the cause celeb, is that it young people, as they feel the seriousness of this world, it freaks them out. And they say, man, I just don't want to go into that seriousness. And so they want to laugh. But they're not really allowed to laugh. They're being trained to suppress their laughter so that they take this world seriously. So when you come into this world, you are systematically pressured to take the world seriously. This is like a very serious situation here. And you have this tremendous resistance to that. And as this seriousness begins to grab hold of you, you freak out and say, oh my God, I feel like I'm dying. In other words, I'm taking death seriously. And that's when young people then turn to drugs, actually. Like marijuana, it helps you laugh. It makes everything, it drops the seriousness of the world. It makes you feel like the world isn't that serious a place. It's all silly and funny. And you laugh, start laughing, etc., etc. But it's an artificial aid to that. It's actually just triggering, it's working at the body level, triggering this. But it's not working at the level of clarity. Okay, so it gets addictive. And you don't have that fresh, clean realization of Spirit from there. It becomes a crutch. And super addictive, you know. It's not so much that it's metabolically addictive. It's addictive at a different level, where people feel they simply cannot function at all without it, because if they don't have it, they feel this seriousness is just looming like this monster, and they feel they're just gonna be crushed by it. So it becomes like psychologically addictive, very psychologically addictive, as a matter of fact, extraordinarily so. So you see, as the times become, projections become more and more severe in the world, more and more people are desperately turning to drugs like marijuana to just try and cope with this encroaching disaster that's coming, catastrophes that are coming, so they can try and laugh at it all. But that doesn't really solve the problem at all. The seriousness is still there. The projections are still there. It hasn't been undone at the root at all. It's just, it's like you're in severe pain, you're taking a painkiller. That is what it is. Let's face it, marijuana is this form of self-medication. It is a painkiller, psychological painkiller. The dreaded taking the world seriously disease. It's an attempt to cut the symptoms down. But it doesn't address the cause of it, the root cause, at all. And that is the problem. If huge problem. There's going to be this massive collapse and this gigantic pressure to take it all seriously, to believe that humanity and nature are real, that it's actual life, and therefore there's this horrible collapse of life taking place, and to take that seriously. There's just this enormous pressure coming now. And spirit is saying, like, oh my gosh, you know, how do I cope with this? How do I cope? I don't want to, you know. So that's why at this time there's this massive push to legalize marijuana and get it in as many hands as possible around the world, so people will just basically be smoking pot as the world collapses. And literally, I'm telling you, this is the truth. That's what's going to happen. And of course, most people have stockpiles of pharmaceuticals, actually, whether it's painkillers, of hardcore painkillers, over-the-counter painkillers, cough syrups, and of course, there are meth labs everywhere. People are, again, trying to use that as a stimulant to make them feel like they can still cope. Okay, as things get worse and worse, the projections of spirit, of spirit trying to train itself how to die, get stronger and stronger. You get all these different ways to try to cope with it. Now, the way I see to cope with it, short of enlightenment, which is the ultimate coping device because it's the seriousness, it vanishes. But honestly, that it is the answer, but how many are going to get that at this point, you know? How many, really? Let's not be naive here. I don't even know if I'm gonna get it in time. Maybe not. Very, very few are going to awaken. Very few. Most likely. If any, actually. If any. It could be that nobody drops it, chooses a new idea, accepts the simulation of no loss. It might be that nobody on the whole planet does this. It's possible. So, what my answer is distancing myself from the intensity of projections here on this planet, which means relocation. That's just a very reasonable goal. Very reasonable goal. Because I'm aware that of the disadvantages of the other ways. You know, I can obviously see the different coping mechanisms that people are using right now. And the severe drawbacks of those. I certainly don't want to lose the clarity that I have already. But it's entirely possible that I could lose it. Absolutely. Get dragged down into projecting death on the body. Absolutely. So, again, what the Holy Spirit has shown me is relocation. Relocation. Where it's possible to continue on with the clarifications and then eventually enlightenment. Which is to laugh at this, silly idea of not to take this quest seriously at all. To drop the seriousness of it entirely. That's really the answer. The answer is to drop the seriousness of this quest entirely. You give it no seriousness thought at all. None. And it's just bliss, laughter and bliss. To realize that what you are cannot be touched by death or anything. It's utterly ridiculous. And so you're not then projecting this, you're not trying to hide the silliness of it from yourself by projection. See, projection hides the silliness of it. It hides it. It makes it seem obscure. So spirit doesn't laugh. Spirit keeps taking it seriously because it seems to be coming externally. It's all out there that all this death is taking place. And Spirit's like observing and looking at it, say, oh, it's coming, it's out there. And there is some serious death taking place. It's out there. And I need to monitor this and see what's going on. And of course, it's equally silly to try to fix it. Say, wait a minute, the death is coming from out there, but I need to stop this death before it gets to me, so I don't try to fix it out there. That is just compounding the craziness, really, to try and stop it. The stopping of it is for Spirit to stop taking it seriously, as if it has some possibility of success. Seriousness needs, it has some, Spirit believes that it can succeed. If Spirit realizes there's zero possibility of death succeeding, zero, how could I take anything, all this impermanence seriously at all at that point? It could not. Could not. So that's what the realizers say, is they have this breakthrough, and then they realize they don't take it seriously at all anymore. They don't take death seriously at all, on the slightest bit. That's what they say. So I believe them. From what I have seen, I believe them. That there is some step, that breakthrough does happen in the whole thing, nature, existence, humanity, bodies, death, no seriousness to it whatsoever. And they just in bliss and just laugh. They just laugh. And we think they're crazy, and not. We're the ones that are crazy to take it seriously. So, those who don't distance themselves from this severe projection which is taking place now in the world, it's just the severity of projection has gotten really severe. It will become ever more so. If they choose to not distance themselves from it, they're going to try to cope with the situation in other ways. And everybody has their ways, and some are combinations of stuff. They can binge. They try binging on sex, drugs, and rock and roll. That's the basic threesome of the approach to trying to cope with this, and not, in other words, not take it too seriously. It's like Spirit doesn't want to take this thing too seriously, but in order to hide the fact from itself that it's complete farce, it has no choice, if it wants to maintain this idea, to amplify the seriousness of it, to try and amplify it. In other words, to try and treat its lack of seriousness. So it tries to make the situation super serious. Super serious. And of course it doesn't like that. It hates it. So it then tries to medicate itself, medicate somehow, when the situation gets super serious, to try and tamp it down somehow. So that it uses the basic threesome of sex, drugs, and rock and roll. In other words, music, drugs of some type, and then and sensuality in all its various facets. It tries to use that to try and cut the feeling of seriousness down. But of course it doesn't solve anything. Super addictive, and ends up with all sorts of bad side effects, etc. Those don't work. That threesome doesn't work. And yet, you can see the world. People are stratifying into how are they going to deal with the situation. And of course, the other, you might say, is attack. Attack. Is to embrace the seriousness of it and then project the dislike of that seriousness, which automatically arises. Spirit doesn't like this. Automatically, the embrace seriousness, then you project your dislike of that seriousness onto an enemy out there, part of nature, part of humanity. They're the causing this feeling of dislike that you have, and then you attack them. So another way of dealing with this situation is war, conflict, severe conflict. So again, Spirit hates this seriousness. It can't stand it. It wants this it to be over, but it wants it to succeed. It wants to learn how to die so it can be prime creator, so it can be reborn, resurrected as new spirit. But it hates the training exercises. So it's always looking for some way to have its cake and eat it too. Have the seriousness, but not feel it so badly. So if you drop the coping mechanisms, what happens? Then you feel the seriousness of it. And you say, wow, that's terrible. So the spiritual path is really to feel the seriousness of it without any coping mechanisms. And then use the dislike of that to fuel your inquiry. That is what the spiritual path is all about. Use your dislike of these training exercises to fuel your inquiry into dropping the exercises altogether as not necessary, as ridiculous. Don't take it seriously at all anymore. So generally speaking, almost without exception, the spiritual path is arrived at and used when you find out the other ways don't work. The sex, the drugs, and the rock and roll don't work. and the war. The coping mechanisms to try and cut down your dislike of this training exercises. Those coping mechanisms cause so much peripheral trouble for you. It makes things feel even worse that finally you say, forget it. I'm just going to have to look at the seriousness and see if I can't drop it altogether. Because the coping mechanisms are just a bad trip, really a bad trip. That's why you often have people who've had severe coping mechanisms, like alcoholism, for instance, drop it and sometimes become enlightened or become very into the spiritual path. They become their addiction, instead of being addicted to alcohol, they're now addicted to the spiritual path. But the problem there is the path is not an end in itself. And at some point you have to drop the path. And so it feels like a dropping of a coping mechanism, so it's frightening. It's very frightening. Say, I won't have any coping mechanism anymore. And so it has to be resolved at the root. What I've seen is a lot of spiritual teachers were ex-addicts. Ex-addicts. And of course, as again I said, most people who come to the spiritual path are addicts. They're addicted to some coping mechanism, and they realize it's never going to work for them, and then they say, boy, I really have to try something else. So they try the spiritual path. And they come they become addicted to that. And they're more into their addiction than they are to end the path. And so the spiritual path, that becomes an end in itself. And they don't actually reach enlightenment. They don't actually drop the seriousness of it all, because they still want to keep the spiritual path as a coping mechanism. They don't go deep enough into the root of it all. That's what I've seen. So you become addicted to religion, addicted to a spiritual path. That's another coping mechanism instead of the final resolution. The dropping of the seriousness, spirit no longer taking this quest seriously at all. And so just like in any sort of addiction, like alcoholism, alcoclics, they support each other's addiction, saying, no, this, you need to keep doing this, because they can't admit to themselves that it doesn't work. So they see someone else who's also an addict, and they insist, no, it's going to work for you. What that does is reflects back their own belief that it'll work for them too. So the spiritual addicts, religious addicts, etc., they all reflect to one another that they need to stay addicted to the path. They need the path. The problem is the goal of the path is to drop the path, and that you don't need anything, because you don't need seriousness itself. You don't need any projection. You don't need seriousness. And the problem is, on the spiritual path, is you get around all these people who are on the spiritual path, is they reinforce the need for the spiritual path maintaining it in debt forever as a coping mechanism, and then therefore you don't finish it, you don't drop it. So that becomes a barrier in itself too. It becomes another coping mechanism with side effects. Part of the side effects are a feeling of non-functionality within the world. Now, what we've been told by those who are enlightened throughout the seriousness of it, they actually have become very functional, super functional. They don't do more than they need to do. But whatever it is that they need to do, it's a piece of cake for them. Piece of cake. Whereas in being addicted to the spiritual path, one tends to become very non-functional. Which I'm experiencing. So it is definitely possible to be enlightened. I'm convinced of that, absolutely convinced of that. And in fact, that's the only answer, is to for spirit to stop taking its quest seriously. That's the only answer there is. There isn't any other answer. Spirit has to do that at some point. The question is, how does spirit get to that point? And what kind of steps does spirit need to take to get to that point? And the idea is the Holy Spirit orchestrates the path in some way to get to that point. And the question is, can we get to that point in what is happening in the world right now? That's up to this, as far as I know, for me, it's like, I'm thinking like, maybe not, maybe not. Maybe relocation is necessary to a situation that is not so intensely serious. Training exercise that has not gotten so incredibly serious for some situation. So these are issues that wisdom will bring up and say, hey, this is what needs to be discussed at this point in time. This is like a discussion of what is truly relevant at this time point in time in the world. This is truly relevant. What we're talking about is really relevant. The rest of the stuff is just, people are just desperately trying to get into coping mechanisms, trying to find, how can I put a bubble around myself so I can have my cake and eat it too? I can go through the training exercise, but not suffer the dislike of it too much. Because I see the drugs can only take so much. I mean, you can only take so much methamphetamine before you turn into like a zombie, walking corpse. And of course, people who have been trying to use that as a coping mechanism, I mean, it came from World War II, actually, methamphetamine. Germans developed it for their soldiers. And in wartime, it enabled the soldiers to stay wide awake for long periods of time and not need food or anything like that. But of course, the side effects are well known, but just unbelievably terrible side effects very quickly. And of course, they didn't care at that time so much, because the notion was the soldiers were going to die anyway at some point. It's just that before they died, they would help the overall objective of destroying the enemy first, but in the effort to do so, they would die. So the ravages of methamphetamine would not really be so show up or be so noticeable, because they'd be in the ground. And the command and control structure would then still be functioning fine. So that from that development of this, people have been using more and more and more to try and feel that they can cope with the problems of the world, and that they can remain in charge, and that they can defeat their enemies. again, as I said, spirit hates the feeling of this seriousness of this training exercise. And one way to deal is it embraces the training exercises as totally necessary. So I love this. I'm such a challenge. I'm so grateful to have this. They embrace it, the seriousness of it all, the opportunity of the training exercise. But this brings about a revulsion deep within. They can't stand it. And that gets projected. In order to keep this so-called love of it, that they have to project it outwards. It gets projected outwards somewhere. And eventually it coalesces into an enemy out there, and they need to defeat the enemy. So methamphetamine is used to give this feeling of invincibleness, that one can defeat one's enemy. So that's why it's such a severe problem in the world right now. And it is really a much worse problem than people realize. It is spreading throughout the world. Laboratories, it's so easy to make, and there's so many laboratories around the world, small little laboratories. It gives one a feeling of invincibility in defeating one's enemies. And then this seems to be the answer to all problems, right? You say, okay, once I defeat my enemy, then my embracing of the seriousness of existence won't have any bad feeling within at all, be gone, and I will be on the road to salvation perfectly, without any problems. See, it is a most insidious thing. Same with cocaine. It gives a feeling of invincibility to be able to vanquish one's enemies. Whether the enemy might be an intellectual problem, or a problem at work, or I need to invent this, I need to just, you know, business thing, whatever. Feeling of invincibility that I can conquer all. Same with caffeine. Caffeine is the same thing. It's not as strong as cocaine. It's not as strong as methamphetamine, of course. But it's the very same thing. That's why I stay away from caffeine like it was. It's death itself. It really is death in this way. It leads down a slippery slope towards thinking that you can get away with your projections. You can embrace the seriousness of existence and then project the dislike of that out there to an enemy, and you can defeat that enemy, whatever form that enemy takes. It fuels that whole cycle of projection. All those stimulants fuel it. And that puts you into a horrible, horrible cycle. Horrible. Eventually, if you keep going with that, you're going to bottom out, whether it's on methamphetamine or something else. It'll catch up to you eventually. Maybe not this lifetime. Maybe not this lifetime. It caught up to me this lifetime because of previous lifetimes, actually. So this is something I know. I know my previous life. I know what my habits were, etc. And I mainline espresso coffee. I was one of those wealthy enough to actually get the original espresso machines, the automated machines that were able to easily get espresso. And I just mainlined that every day. And that enabled me to do an incredible amount of work and be incredibly successful. I thought I wouldn't pay the price. I paid the price this lifetime. Incredibly severe price. So when I feel down now, which I do a lot, I'm desperate for a cup of coffee. I mean, like instantly, if you have coffee, instantly you feel your problems disappearing because you feel that you have the energy to defeat the problems. Whereas without it, I feel I don't have enough energy to defeat the problems out there. And therefore the depression comes in, like I'm feeling crushed. So the temptation to have coffee is like severe. But I say no, and if I do that, I know that's it. Death is going to get me. So I haven't had any caffeine in a year and a half. None. Not even once. I was at a party a couple days ago, and they had Coke and Diet Coke and stuff, and I was like severely tempted to pour some Diet Coke. Diet Coke has more caffeine than regular Coke. I said, I was super tired, just trembling and shaking, exhausted. I said, wow, at this party, I don't want to be so down. Maybe I'll have a good time, but just a little Diet Coke. You know? And instead I said, no, you know you do that, you're toast. And so I said, so I poured 7-Up, had 7-Up in water instead. But we don't realize the situation we're in. We really don't. We think, oh, no, that won't cause a problem. Yes, many times I've gone through that. And it's amazing how fast the wheels come off. Amazing. Because as soon as you get that confidence you can defeat your problems, you immediately end up, you start resonating with other people that have the same attitude. Like that. And suddenly these people become very attractive to you. And you feel like part of this quest. And you can then you can fall in step with that feeling of other that others have, just like immediately. And it's like, whoa. And then that pulls you into the entire energy of this trying to defeat the feeling that you can, the defeating your enemies, whatever they may be, whether it's the enemy is lack of money, whatever it is, feeling that you can succeed. You get into the success thing and you get immediately resonate with those people. Whereas now, I don't resonate with success at all, which is why I don't have any friends or I don't fall into any group at all, because I don't have this feeling of success at all, except enlightenment. So I'm invisible to people. It's amazing. When you do not have this feeling that you can vanquish your enemies, that you can be successful, which ultimately means getting rid of this dislike of the training exercises. That's what actually, when people say success, that's what they're talking about. Since I don't have that at all, I don't resonate at all with success. I'm invisible because success only sees success. That's all it sees. It doesn't see anything else. So I literally move about the world and my feeling is that I'm invisible to people. They don't even notice me, not even recognizable to them. And it's true. It's amazing. Like I'll be standing in line and someone will walk right in front of me. And there'll be other people in line, for instance. This happens a lot. And the other people in line, they see what happens. They kind of look, like, and then they kind of look at me, and I'll finally say something. Did you realize I was standing in line? And someone's like, oh, I'm sorry, I didn't recognize you. And the other people in line will see what's happening. They'll shake their heads and say, whoa, that is weird. It happens all the time like that with me. So many different situations, people just look and say, wow, that was really weird. Well, why? How could they not see you? That's bizarre. Because the more these people resonate with success, the less visible I become to them. Which is why in the Silicon Valley, I'm virtually invisible, because here the whole place is simply resonating with success. The whole thing was fueled on caffeine and cocaine. And it's totally all about success here. And so I literally feel like I don't exist here, because nobody recognizes me. I'm a non-entity here. Because I don't believe in success at all, except the ultimate success in dropping the quest to accomplish the impossible, which is not the definition of success that the world recognizes at all. And when I go somewhere else out of the Silicon Valley, it's like people, they recognize me. Not my name, I think, but they recognize that there's someone is there. It's the weirdest thing. I'm like stunned by it. It's like, hey, somebody recognize I exist. They're walking, they'll smile and you know, hi, you know. And the recognition. It's like, oh my gosh, I exist. There's a recognition. And it's amazing. Whereas here in Silicon Valley, I don't get that. It's like I don't exist. A little bit, there are a few people, but the overwhelming feeling is I don't exist at all. And that's why I want to get out of this place. But ultimately, the notion that of non-existence, when enlightenment takes care of that. So it doesn't even matter whether you're recognized or not. That's what the gurus tell us. The enlightened ones say, makes no difference to me whether anyone recognizes me or not. It's all the same. There's no seriousness to any of it. Because identity is self-evident. It's always, I am always nothing and everything. How could I not be what I am? You see? When the recognition of the self occurs, it is a recognition that I am nothing, always nothing, and everything simultaneously. I am that. That's why they say, Sri Nisargadatta said, I am that. What does that mean? It means simultaneously everything and nothing. See, he didn't say I am space. He didn't say I am these things. He said, I am that. That is the term which is used to encompass nothing and everything simultaneously. So if what we are is nothing and everything, how could we lose our identity? Where could we lose it? How could it be lost? If we say, well, I'm nothing, that it too is one with my identity. Or I say, well, I'm everything, that too is one with my identity. Or I say, I'm that thing, well, that's included in everything. Or I'm not that thing, that's also included in my identity as nothing. So you have, what we are is the entirety. So how could we not have our identity? How could we lose our identity? It's impossible. So there's zero concern about loss of identity, loss of any, in those who've awakened, those who are enlightened. There is no more concern. So how could be any seriousness about this issue of loss? How can I be lost to myself? How can we be lost to ourselves? The whole notion that we can be lost to ourselves is the completely hilarious. That's what we forgot to laugh at. We forgot to laugh at the notion that somehow we could be lost to ourselves, because we are both nothing and everything. Where could we be lost? Could we be lost in nothingness? No. Could we be lost in everythingness? No. So we think we could be lost in just specifically just this thing. I am just this thingness, and that is my lostness. We try to identify as narrow as possible, narrow our identification down, you see, thinking that just this little point here, you know, that's what I am. But that little point is still everything and nothing. And, you know, this is a further investigation of how we try to get lost. But the fact remains, we cannot get lost, and yet we still think that we can. We take it seriously that we can get lost. We can be lost to ourselves, lost to ourselves. Realization is just meaning that we realize we cannot be lost to ourselves. That's all it is. We cannot be lost to ourselves. And then the great relaxation comes, and we cannot be lost. I cannot be lost to myself. And I know it's possible. I have faith it's possible. I have not reached that condition yet. I have not realized I cannot be lost to myself yet. But I understand the parameters, the context, etc. And I see that is the resolution. That is. So eventually, at no point it will take place. When they realize there is no point where it needs to take place at all. Because again, everything and nothing, is at a point? Or is it a lack? There is no point to our identity. Perhaps there's no point to our identity. There's a little room for further clarification is what I'm seeing here. Little room for further clarification. So we're building up to that realization. It's not some mysterious thing. I want to take the mystery out of it. That's really what I'm about. I want to take the mystery and mystique out of it. Because that gets in the way. Gets in the way. I want to take the idea that's just luck, or, you know, just some, it's so mysterious that we just think, well, it just, maybe it'll just happen someday. It'll just lucky or something. I want to take that out of it entirely. And see very clearly what it's all about. Again, self-realization means the realization that I cannot be lost unto myself. Cannot. That's what it is. So we have, in this video, we've been able to build up to that, gotten to that height, near the summit, very near the summit, as it were. Not yet standing on the summit. I cannot be lost unto myself. That is the realization. It's impossible to be lost unto myself. Time and space only makes it seem possible or plausible because there seems to be a search taking place. That's a projection. It's a projection of seriousness upon, it's a projection of seriousness upon nature. Nature seems to be lost unto itself. Humanity seems to be lost unto itself, etc. But that's not the question, is it? The question is spirit lost unto itself. See, that we have to reformulate our questions, actually. The spiritual path is really a way to reformulate the questions. It's a willingness to reformulate questions. So when one goes to an enlightened guru teacher, don't expect that your questions will be entertained, because the whole point of it is to reformulate your questions. So if you're unwilling to reformulate your questions and demanding an answer to your question, you're not making use of the help at all. You're not on the path, you're not at that point. Have to reformulate the questions. So, it's not that nature needs to find itself. It's not that humanity needs to find itself. It's that spirit needs to recognize it. It can never be lost unto itself. So here is spirit that is not lost unto itself, all concerned about nature and humanity, saying, oh my gosh, nature is so lost unto itself, humanity is so lost unto itself. I need to fix this, I need to heal this, I need to evolve the consciousness of this. It's lost unto itself. This is a big project I got here. That's delusion. That is to the heart of delusion. That's how spirit perpetuates its delusion. Because spirit is not lost unto itself, it's impossible. But it's has this endeavor, it's hiding the fact that it's trying to be lost unto itself by claiming that it's working on this huge project of existence, of raising the consciousness of existence, because existence is lost unto itself. Not seeing this is all a projection of spirits, of its own intent and seriousness upon the tabula rasa, the blank slate of nature embodies this, of symbols, and then animating its symbols and feeling its own projection. So we're getting very close, and when that happens, there's a blowback effect, kind of like you say, whoa, do I really want to go any more further? So we can get an insight, and then we kind of take a little one step back and say, whoa. So that's why I continue this taping. I reached a very high point there, and then sort of like, whoa, fall back, just a little, slide back a little bit. So it's a reformulating the questions. It's a willingness to think, okay, you know, how can I reshape this question I'm having? Reshape the question. Reshape the question. If you reshape the question, then obviously you're going to see a different answer. So, as long as we're trying to get humanity to the top of the mountain, we're deluded. We remain enmeshed in the seriousness and the coping mechanisms. As long as we're trying to get something to the top of the mountain, we will not realize that we are already on the top of the mountain. We never left. We were never lost unto ourselves. In other words, we've always been enlightened. Spirit cannot help, can't be anything other than enlightened. In other words, spirit cannot help but not be lost to itself. It's impossible for spirit to be lost to itself. So spirit's always not lost to itself. But spirit has been, again, focused on, from the mountaintop down below, all this activity in the jungle, and trying to raise up the jungle to the mountaintop. And that's how spirit perpetuates its attempt to annihilate itself, actually. It can be lost to itself. How does it perpetuate this when it's not lost to itself? By, again, projecting this seriousness of being lost to itself upon symbols where it seems plausible, or whether it's a dance of plausibility, the play of plausibility. You have nature, humanity, bodies, etc., projecting on there, and then trying to help that projection, the symbols, not be lost unto itself. But symbols, you cannot even speak in terms of whether it's lost to itself or not, is nothing. I mean, it's not an issue at all. It's not life. And so, but spirit keeps taking this seriously, thinking it needs to help. Help nature find itself. Help humanity find itself. That is the delusion. That is the ridiculousness. Because again, in doing that, spirit is denying its own identity as everything and nothing simultaneously. So how could there be any loss at all? There can't. Even symbols are part of everything and nothing. They're part of the nothing aspect. So there's this feeling of coming to-ness. Of spirit here is recognizing this now. Spiritual path is about recognition, reformulating your questions so that you see the different answers, say, oh, this is the goal, and then reformulate and get, and then a coming, sort of coming to spirit, sort of not taking it seriously and realizing it can't be lost unto itself. And this is all just an attempt to do that. And then when spirit realizes it cannot be lost unto itself, then you have what people term enlightenment, which is really bliss, which is the relief, the great relief. And then the great calm. The great calm, it knows that spirit cannot be lost to itself. Ramana Maharshi knew that spirit, the self, cannot be lost unto itself. Absolutely abided in this, knowing of this. So, total calm, total calm. Same with Anandamayama, total calm. Complete calmness. And people say, how can you be so calm? Aren't you worried about being lost to yourself? And they said, no, not at all. So this, the dance that's coming up of loss and nature and bodies, etc., is designed to keep spirit intensely focused on loss, of course, of saying, pointing out, look, you see, nature, how much is lost, nature lost so much unto itself, extinction level event causes a severe loss unto itself, and then spirit will say, you see, loss is possible, look at that, look at all that loss, wow, not realizing that spirit can never be lost unto itself, and not recognizing why this is so, that it's simultaneously nothing and everything, meaning that it's impossible for anything to be left out of that, meaning there isn't any loss taking place actually at all. No loss of identity at all. No loss of identity. When we talk about the loss that spirit's serious about, concerned about, it means loss of identity, loss of self, loss of what we are. And all this loss in nature is not causing loss of identity. Loss of human life, etc., is not causing loss of identity. Because identity is nothing and everything, both simultaneously. One unity, a unity of that. So I am that, and that can't suffer any loss at all. So when Jesus says that there's no death taking place at all, he means that death of identity. Of course, forms are appearing and disappearing all constantly, but Jesus means death of identity. There's no death of identity taking place whatsoever, none. And that's the only meaningful death there is. It's the only meaning death could possibly have. Because what is nothing cannot die. What is not, has no identity at all cannot die. Was never Because it's only a hypothetical. It's a hypothetical. It's not real at all. So when Jesus says, well, you're not perceiving the ants are invading our home, and sometimes we have to wipe them up. I've actually gotten away from that. What I do is I remove the food, what they're feeding on, clean that up, and then automatically they retreat overnight, you know, back to their lair, their little home, and so they're gone, so I don't have to kill them. But let's say someone else deals with it when the sprays of Lysol on them or something. Jesus says that we're misperceiving that. I said, what are you talking about? The ant is dead. I believe he's talking about that. He says, well, the ant was never alive in the first place. So in perceiving death, you're perceiving life where it isn't. In other words, imaginary dream. You're misperceiving the whole situation. It's not just you're misperceiving the death of the ant, you're misperceiving the life of the ant too. That it's a symbol representing identity, and identity is not a symbol. So I believe that's what Jesus is talking about. So nothing's dying. There's no death at all. Because death, to have any meaning at all, it has to be death of what is life, and life is identity. And identity is nothing and everything, both. So how can there be any loss of identity at all? How can identity be lost? It can't. So identity cannot die. So all this stuff that seems to be death isn't death at all. It's not death at all. There is no death taking place. Nothing has ever died. That's another statement you can hear. Nothing has ever died. There's never been any death at all. It's just that this ant, it seems to be lost to what? To nature. So it seems to be that there's a loss taking place relative to nature. But this is all, symbols are only relative to themselves. Illusions are only relative to other illusions. But nature is not being lost to everything and nothing. See, it's not. There's no actual loss taking place. There's no actual loss of identity taking place. So I know viewers may be struggling with this, you know, how do I put this together? Don't worry about that. It's like a stretching exercise. It's just stretching, and stretch. And then next day you'll feel, hey, I feel really limber. I feel really limber. It's like that. It's the limberness that we're going towards. It's the capacity then to easily reconnect with this central truth, so we can again look at it until we can say, ah, piece of cake. So again, don't struggle with the intellect. I got to grasp this intellectually. Just feel the stretching that's taking place. Like, wow. Feel the wowness of it. Nothing has ever died. Feel the wowness of that. Nothing. There's never been any death. That is a fact. There's never been any death ever, and never will be. Now feel the wowness of that. If it is true, it's absolutely true. There's never been any loss. Nothing has ever been lost. There's never been any loss take place. Now imagine how great that's going to feel. There's never been any death take place. There's never been any loss take place. And imagine the laughter that one will have over the silly joke that we believed that was possible. And then the relief that will take place. It's very different than the belief that all this loss is taking place, but I just need to take drugs to make myself feel better. And I feel terrible about it, but if I take these drugs, I don't feel quite as bad. Obviously, you know, that's a dead-end game, because the loss from illusions, the illusion of loss will continue on until you realize that there's never been any loss. So in other words, the answer to existence is to realize that there's never been any existence. Literally, the answer to all this death and loss is to realize there's never been any death or loss. It's not to say I found a drug which will take away the misery and shock and trauma of all this loss. Because again, the illusion of loss continues on until we see it is nothing but an illusion. That it's never taking place. again, it's not that it's taken place and we found a remedy to calm our trauma of this. That is a dead end. Very much so. And eventually, at some point, you just realize you just wasted all your time. You could have been on a spiritual path all along, and you just wasted your time. So I realized early on that this was a waste of time. I got wise. I said, holy cow, I don't want to waste my life. Got to get to work on this. So what happens when you get to work on this? You get to a point where you can first say it, that there's never been any death and there's never been any loss, and believe it and know it and feel it, so this is true, and then eventually self-realization will come. And then you're obviously finished with it, because you realize that what can never take place, how can you be engaged with it actually? You've never really engaged with it at all. So of course the engagement is, you feel free of that. You realize you're not engaged with death, and you're not engaged with loss. Never have been, never will be. So, peace of mind at that point. Peace of mind. Now, hopefully, YouTube editor will work on this, because I'm having severe problems being able to upload these videos. Now, YouTube editors have become bulky. It doesn't want to edit. I have to put 20-minute segments together, put them, upload those to YouTube, put them in YouTube editor, edit them to one video, and then render that. And lately YouTube hasn't been refusing to render these videos. Big problem. And when I try to put them in a video editing program on my computer is so messed up, it doesn't want to do that either. I tried to put the audio of these onto a photo story thing using photos. That crashed too. So it's like I'm getting squeezed down to almost no way to put these videos on YouTube. So hopefully if you're watching this, I found a way to do it. Because these videos are important, they're helpful. Anything that brings you to see and hear, there's never been any loss and there's never been any death. And to recognize there's a context for it. This is not some spiritual psychobabble, not at all. I hope that's coming through in these videos. That's why I make them long. I explain the context behind this. It's not just some trickster, some guru trickster saying, there is no death, there is no loss, come worship me, or blah, blah, blah. There's clear, total, contextual basis for saying this here. Solid, solid, solid foundation for saying this. It's an unequivocal conclusion to the equation that we've set up here. You see, this is this, and this is this, and this is this, therefore, and you can see it. It's using reason. We don't want to get tricked by the guru tricksters. A lot of them in the world. Don't want to get tricked by them anymore. We want to actually realize that I cannot be lost unto myself, to actually realize it. No more tricksters. No more slaving for these tricksters, doing savor service for these tricksters to build up their bank accounts, build up their self-image, because that's their addiction. See, that's another addiction, coping mechanism. Some develop that coping mechanism of being gods and goddesses in training, as it were, and they abuse and those that fall into that pattern, exploit them severely, severe exploitation. We don't want to fall in that either. We want to actually realize that what we are, we cannot be lost unto ourselves. Impossible, totally impossible, and realize it. So we make these declarations that bring us closer. There's never been any death, and there's never been any loss. I have never suffered any death. I have never suffered any loss. Say that declaration. I have never suffered any death. I have never suffered any loss. It's totally impossible for me to ever suffer any loss or any death. Totally impossible. I just say that. That is a declaration of freedom. It's impossible for life to be lost unto itself. Totally impossible. Reality cannot be lost unto itself. Life cannot be lost unto itself. Truth cannot be lost unto itself. I cannot be lost unto myself. Identity cannot be lost unto itself. There is simply no way, no how to accomplish this. So it's never happened. Death has never happened. Loss has never happened. Impermanence has never happened. So who is it that doesn't want these things said? And I've said in the previous video, it's the gooey tricksters. From all nations, of course, a lot of them come from India. The guru tricksters don't want you to say these declarations. Because that they feel that their capacity to exploit is being diminished that way. And their exploiting of others is their drug, is their addiction to keep the seriousness, their seriousness going, to believe it is possible. They need this, to have this addiction fed. They need their addictions fed. So when you say, I, you can say right where you are that identity can never be lost unto itself. I've never been lost unto myself. I've never experienced death. I've never experienced loss. I can never experience loss. I can never experience death. I can never experience loss of identity. Saying these declarations, that puts you beyond the spiritual tricksters right away. When you say them, you say, hey, I can say this. I can realize this. I don't need this guru to worship this guru to not lose myself. No, I can say these things right here, right now. So it's genuine empowerment. Genuine empowerment. I cannot ever be lost unto myself. I've never been lost unto myself. I can never experience loss of any kind. I can never experience death of any kind. There is no loss. There is no death. There's never been any loss. There's never been any death. It's never even taken place. There's never been any impermanence. Impermanence has never happened. Impermanence has never happened. So it's not that we're saying this world has never happened. Okay. It's not quite like that. We're saying impermanence has never happened. It's a higher way of looking at it. So don't say the world is real and then say that it's never happened. No, redefine it. There's never been a world. There has never been a world. There's never been nature. There's never been impermanence. It's never been. It's literally never been. It's never been there. There's only been that. We've been stuck in our definitions. We've demanded this definition of what's taking place. We demanded that there's this world. There's a world here. World of impermanence. No, there's not. There is no world of impermanence anywhere. We've been stuck in our own projections to maintain our seriousness about all this. So to that, we need to work at it from that angle. Don't say there's a world here and then deny it. Say there's never been a world here. There has never been a world. There's never even been a universe, as a matter of fact. There's never been a universe. So this, whatever this is, it's not a universe. Whatever this is not a world. Whatever this is not a body. There's never been any bodies. There's never been any world. There's never been any universe. All of this is simply projection. It's a misidentification, as it were. That's why Jesus says all of this is simply a misperception. It's all a misperception, which is one way of saying it. So it's not like we need to get rid of the world. We need to realize there's never been a world. It's very different, right? Very different. We're saying there has never been a world, and there never will be a world. There will be. What are we dwelling in then? We're dwelling in our identity. We're always at home. We are always at home in our identity. We are simply identity resting in identity. That is what we are. And we don't need any music for this. We don't need a soundtrack for this. We gotta go beyond that stuff. That's used, that stuff is used to sugarcoat in. It's a coping mechanism, really. I am simply resting in I am. Is all there is. Again, there is no world. Never has been. So change the questions. Don't ask, what is this world? There is no world. What are these things? There are no things. What is this death? There is no death. What is this loss? There is no death. None of this. There's only identity resting in identity. That is all there is. There's only oneness resting in oneness. That's why they say when the self-realization, there's only God. That's what a man of my mom would say. There's only God resting in God. That's all there is. There is nothing else. She says that the enlightenment, the vision of this unity, this oneness, only God is, that's freedom, that's liberation. Because that's all there's ever been. It's not that this tree is, you know, no. There is no tree. There's never been a tree. There's only God. There's only identity. There's only identity resting in identity. That's all. That's reality. What else could there be? There can't be anything else. So, there's simply identity resting in identity. So this is profound stuff, but it's very approachable. I want to show you it's approachable. We don't need to get all scared. Oh, no, it's very approachable. We're just approaching it here on a Saturday morning, just chatting about it. This is how Saturday morning should go. This is how Sunday morning should go. You say, well, you go to church. Is this what you hear at church or in your synagogue? Or in your mosque, or in your meditation hall, or in wherever, you know, you go. Is this what you're hearing? Is this the chat? Is this where your focus is? Is this what other people are hearing? There is no universe. There is no world. There's only identity resting in identity. There's never been a world. There's never been a universe. Is this what you're hearing? If not, then hey, recognize that. That's not what you're hearing. Hearing something else altogether. There is no impermanence. There's never been any impermanence. And Jesus said it's a misperception. But this needs to be thoroughly understood. Those are just words. It's easy to misunderstand words. It's really a projection. And that's another word too. So words can only be used to kind of get flexible towards realization. I cannot be lost unto myself. Identity cannot be lost unto itself. So therefore, it never has been lost unto itself. And therefore, it's always been abiding in itself. So to say that something's a permanence implies loss. There cannot be any loss. So at that point, I would say probably everything is just seen as this whimsical dance, meaningless whimsical dance. But again, identity is completely blissful about it all, because it simply has the bliss of identity residing in itself as it is completely blissful. But it's not even the dance of impermanence at that point. The perception of it all changes. You might say the definition of it changes completely. So it's not that everything needs to disappear. It's our definition of it needs to change. The universe doesn't have to disappear. We need just to define the fact that there has never been a universe. And then, of course, we're still right where we are. Everything is still right where it is. It's just that it's not a universe. It's not a world. It's not nature. It's not anything but identity resting in identity. It's everything and nothing. It's always everything and nothing. Reality is always everything and nothing. Both. And it's important to realize that you can say these declarations right where you are. Because it may be that you may be pinned down in the future. Events may pin you down. And it's very important you recognize that you can do this clarification right where you are, by yourself. I'm doing this right by myself here, just nobody around, nobody supporting, nobody, you know, in any support function at all, really, as far as this content goes. And you can do it right where you are, even if you're pinned down. You can't go anywhere, you just feel stuck. You can still realize there's never been any universe. There's never been any world. There's never been any death. There never will be. There's never been any loss. I cannot be lost unto myself. Completely impossible. I've never been lost unto myself. Loss is impossible. Death is impossible. So it's never been happening. It's never happened. Redefine what's been happening. In fact, from the standpoint of happy, nothing's been happening. What can happen to everything and nothing to change what it is? What can happen to everything and nothing to change what it is the question. I may have to end this video before it gets 2 hours, because the YouTube editor only does two-hour videos. How can everything and nothing be lost unto itself? How can everything and nothing be lost unto itself? Can a universe make it lost unto itself? No, not even a universe can make everything and nothing lost unto itself. Not even a universe. We tried. Therefore, the entire universe can be seen as God, identity residing in identity. And of course, even beyond the universe, what we've used to call the universe, is really endlessness, everything and nothing, as one unity. Where is the loss? How can that be lost unto itself? It used to be these type of talks were given in big gatherings, like Krishnamurti giving a gathering in Ojai or someplace, Belgium, India, etc. The people used to be able to travel to those places. They used to be able to go there. I mean, now, and coming up very soon, it could very well be people who feel very stuck and cannot go anywhere. I already feel that way entirely. So I'm trying to pioneer this new form of satsang for those who are stuck. Well, I'm not trying, I'm doing it. I may be somewhere giving satsang at some point to those all over the world and in their homes, or maybe a little gathering. They might go over to a home and everybody watch on a big screen or a big television set or something, or a widescreen, and have satsang that way, because the ability, the capacity to travel, to take time off from work, to leave one's place, the logistics of it all, to travel on an airplane, to get hotels, to get all these logistics and stuff, along with what's happening in the world, it could be martial law, et cetera, it's not gonna be possible. It won't be possible. Now, here's one thing I wanna say. The boogeyman of the lead, et cetera, is not total. It cannot be total. There will always be some freedom there, and we might be able to get to watch this satsang at your home. That is very possible. They don't have the power, quite have the power that we think they do, or fear that they will have. They can never have that. And they're not completely the ogres that we think they may be. It's not possible. So even in the deepest darkness, there will be rays of light there. So it is very possible that though, even though people may be very pinned down, they will still have access to rays of light, still have access to satsang, which is consideration and looking at what needs to be looked at, is all it is. It's simply looking at what needs to be looked at. Don't try to make it into something mysterious or complex. It is merely looking at what needs to be looked at. That is all. You just sit there. You just sit there in a chair and just look. Identity cannot be lost unto itself. You're just looking at that. How can everything and nothing be lost unto itself? You say, wait, if I look at that, I say, wow, wait a minute. I don't think it can be lost unto itself. So it's simply a looking, and that can be done anywhere. It can be done anywhere, because where are you except in everything and nothing? You are within yourself always. So wherever you are, you can simply recognize this, look at it. Look at it first and recognize it, and then realize it. So, we will see how the days go, but things are shaping up. And it's been my effort to provide this service, to set a model for what can happen, what can take place here, is you may be pinned down, travel may be restricted, etc., but they still may be able to watch on the internet, watch these videos. That is possible. And you, just by looking, you are getting it. You are getting it. Sure, we're making it tough on ourselves in this time. That's the whole purpose of the times. But that doesn't make, we're not making it impossible for ourselves. Absolutely not. It's impossible to make it impossible for ourselves. That's another way of putting it. It is impossible to make it impossible for ourselves to realize that we cannot be lost unto ourselves. Completely impossible. So there will always be some way, but the ways keep shifting and changing because we're trying to make it impossible on ourselves. We can't, but we're trying. And of course, we've never been lost unto ourselves, so we're always abiding in ourselves. We're always self-abiding already. Just we're not defining it that way. We're believing it can be something other than that. Can be in time. We're believing it in some hypothetical land we call time. We believe it can be become impossible, cannot. Again, we're nothing and everything simultaneously. All right, so on where we go, and better and better and better and better and better. Get familiar with this video satsang. Get familiar, because it may be a very helpful form at some time. All right, that's it.